This is a midterm exam done October 26, 1993. It's basically divided into four programs. As I said, the first program is sort of kind of terminology, quickly go over with that. I think some of you eventually will get accustomed to my style. You don't want to spend an awful lot of time trying to explain it, and then you find your time is not enough to the end. But I think most of you manage it. Maybe some of you, the last program didn't have enough time. I give you a kind of eight kind of things to explain. I don't want to go over every one of them. Kolmogorov, everybody seems to know it. Inner law, most of you know it, but I want you to make sure that the inner law, you do need the war shear to be used to express the inner law. Otherwise, without the war shear, you just say appropriate boundary conditions, then it can be non-slip flow or some other things. So make sure that the war shear normally is the people expecting you to say that the inner law is that the velocity profile governed by that equation. Essentially, it come out that the kinematic viscosity, war shear, and the distance, y, is necessary. Ensemble average, everyone knows it. Prandtl number, most of you know the definition, and I think maybe I caught you off guard a little bit. I want the magnitude of air, water, and that one. I think when we went over the material, I did want to say that to make sure, because in the heat transfer or some of the calculation, people prefer to calculate Prandtl number 1, Prandtl number 10, Prandtl number 100. And then you look at it, that essentially imply one is like for gases, like air, nitrogen, oxygen, and so forth. 10 looks like for water, so forth. 100 or 1,000 looks like for very viscous fluid, glycerin, and so forth. I didn't ask for the liquid metal, which is 100th, and then you know the range of the problem you are looking at. Principal exchange of the stability, I think maybe half of you knows when we talk about it. I remember in the two lectures I repeated that it's because of the curve flow. The flow is not continuous making a transition throughout the turbulent. It kind of jump in a discrete way. So from one instability of a flow, jump to another instability of flow, that is the so-called exchange of stability, because you no longer have a rotating Couvert flow, you jump into the kind of donut the shape flow here. Jim, this is your. Okay, thank you. So, since I asked you in the exam, I think from now on you never forget, right? If you ever forget, it's an exchange from one stable flow to another stable flow depending on the inertial force, say the rotating Rayleigh number or rotating Reynolds number. So it's quite often occurred in the curve flow because you do have a centrifugal force and also Coriolis force in there. Osamafeo equation, most of you know it. I want you to remember Osamafeo equation is good for only parallel flow. Okay? If you say that U is a function of Y, I assume you know it. But if you say it's a parallel flow, and then I'm sure that you know it's parallel flow. Small disturbance, many of you forget Osamafeo equation is for one wave at a time or one mode of a frequency at a time. You don't want to analyze the whole thing at the same time. Stock principle, turbulent closure problem, either you remember or you don't remember. If you don't remember, by now you remember because you got to go back and have a look at that. Okay, problem two is essentially I want you to have a good physical feeling about the simple van der Leer flow. Okay, we talk about so much about the van der Leer flow. I want the UV, Reynolds stress, U square K, and the epsilon. Okay, I'm plotting for this one is a U profile. Essentially, I'm looking for see if you give me a near wall shear is increasing or decreasing or no change. some of you draw very nicely. The Shia is all three stations the same. I kind of keep thinking, is this person really knows that the Shia is decreasing or increasing or not? But I'm looking for your drawing of a sharper mile and a little bit more mile. And of course, the outer flow you got to be all the same. Now, the V is harder for you to think because you see the U more. For you to see V, you got to realize it looks like that. There is a kind of a zero slope to start with because U on the wall is zero, so partial U, partial X certainly is zero. Then from continuity equation, you know partial V, partial Y got to be zero, then you know the slope got to start with that. So if you give me a slope to start with, then I said, maybe you forget about that the continuity relation there. A little bit more subtle is that the outside U eventually decreasing in there. If you increase, you are in trouble because you are far downstream. U is just like a spring or something is going to shoot out. Okay, you can go and reason it, but you should not draw it to zero. That everybody outside, because but not there, uniform flow comes in here. Here you have a profile. Where the rest of the flow goes, you got to go out outside of boundary. So okay, make sure that you do that. Reynolds stress. Again, I was looking for the Reynolds stress. You ought to have a larger magnitude, smaller and smaller in terms of peak. If a peak grow a little bit, that's fine because we're looking at the inner law, you already know it. I don't want you to draw the magnitude of Reynolds stress as you go down the station getting bigger. Then you are in trouble because you are far downstream, you are going to an explosive situation, right? So because Reynolds stress, as you take a very simple gradient model, eddy viscosity model, you know it's proportional to gradient. If a gradient become mild, your Reynolds stress ought to go down. Eventually, you relaminarize way downstream in the boundary layer flow. And of course, the outside got to be zero. And the K and the U square essentially should be about the same profile. So I kind of want you to draw. And again, nobody draw the negative value on me, so that's good. Everyone knows it's the positive. And epsilon should have, if you think, the local equilibrium situation where the K is large, epsilon will be large, because epsilon is very hard to think, right? So if you think that is that. There is some subtlety there. Let me explain, because either you draw epsilon equals zero or epsilon non-zero, I give you the credit because I didn't mention about it here. Because if you think, well, at the wall, turbulent goes to zero, epsilon goes to zero. That's kind of very logical feeling, right? But there is a certain, because your laminar sublayer is so thin, so even the laminar sublayer is, you are in the viscous layer, but the laminar sublayer will fluctuate sort of because of outside turbulence going on. So there is a now, there is a paper by Professor Patel and other people, and even in the measurement there, epsilon in general now people think is non-zero at all, okay? And I didn't mention about that one, so if you draw zero, that's fine with me. Eventually I'll get to the point, I'll give you a paper to look at it. But the epsilon should decrease in there again, because the K decrease, you don't have to dissipate so much to do it, so make sure you understand. Epsilon outside the boundary, of course, has to be zero, okay? So I think it's not a whole lot of a mathematics, just your physical feeling of understanding of how the flow goes. The third problem, most of you can do it. Maybe some of you just forget a little bit of detail. The first turn gradient model, and make sure that you are making up of a dimension is L square over T and get a K epsilon. In there you can get it. Some of you maybe missed a little bit of that one, but I didn't take a whole lot of a point out. The production term, the two production term there, this term goes to zero, I think most of you remember, I not equals zero, inside goes to zero, I equals J, outside goes to zero because of incompressible, all right? This term, most of you know it, just say that whereby comparison is small, that's fine. But some of you may compare with the wrong term. that, but by and large, that's okay. The last two terms, we use in Professor Lumley's, I think almost universally, most of people adopt Professor Lumley's argument that this is proportional to the production and dissipation. If a local equilibrium, that means the production and dissipation is equal, Professor Lumley said that term got to be equal to zero. So as a very first approximation is that, and then you time epsilon over T in there because of the dimension. Looking at this side, you have a E over T here. If it's going to be one, the makeup of a dimension got to be epsilon over T. I just substitute the T there, then of course you get C epsilon 1 production over this, and extra epsilon times epsilon over K, then you should get it. So the third problem, most of you can do it. The fourth problem, I thought I was doing you a simplification to give you an easier problem, so I said it's a laminar flow. But somehow, maybe you are just reading very quickly. Maybe you are preoccupied with the turbulent. You are thinking, oh, here is the turbulent. And of course, you study the turbulent. You just pull out the turbulent for me. But then that's all right. At least I know that you know the procedure and the idea to go. Laminar flow actually is much simpler because I also afraid that the U goes in the turbulence, so I write out the equation, which is the laminar equation to you, but some of you just write the turbulent equation anyway. So by laminar flow, the boundary layer, like here, this is like a boundary layer is growing, and you want the boundary layer grow to one half of a channel, most of you can figure them out. So by saying that the inertial force and the dissipation, because viscous force is in action here, the inertial force is here, just by saying that inertial force and the viscous force should be equal, you should be able to find 1 over Reynolds number, the delta square is that, or the delta is 1 over square root of Reynolds number. Now the Reynolds number, of course, at this stage is defined by the distance you are going up. Here, your distance going up here. So now you got a delta. Now all you have to do is one half of the channel is equal to your delta L because of your boundary layer thickness got to be one half of that. So if you equal that one, your end result, very simple, just the developing length over the H is 1/4 times the Reynolds number, which is a converter, I don't have a place to write, it's a converter to the H, the channel height of it. And if you leave all the magnitude 1 out, that's fine with me, but it's somewhere, because the estimate is very crude, so you can see this. Now if you compare with our class note on the turbulence, you find the exponent to the Reynolds number now is different. So you see the laminar flow is much more sensitive to the Reynolds number. The turbulent flow is less sensitive to the Reynolds number. And so I would like you to have that feeling in there. Okay, that is all I have to explain on the exam. Do you have any questions? Okay, if not, if you have any question on my mark, maybe you can see me afterward. I would say ranging the gym coming later, I did announce in the class that the average is 85.6. So I would say most of you is still okay. I don't think anyone is on the failing side of it. Some of you, of course, up to the 95, 94 is very good. Some of them is a little bit lower. But by and large, I think most of you know the material, so I'm happy with my class for now. Okay, let's move on. I want to give you a quick review. Before I review, anything you want to say? Okay, I didn't get around to type what I used to call, you know, you are a professor that every day he is receiving a lot of mail from post office. There will be a call for paper. That means a technical conference, there is a paper, and then they are going to submit a paper. I'm going to send out a call for paper call for presentation on each one of you, and it's a composer, each one of you got to select one. And I didn't get around to type it, but next time I'll give it to you. It's kind of my style of imitating the paper submissions for the faculty. When many of you graduate, you eventually become a faculty, and you receive the announcement, international conference, or the SIAM, American Society of Applied Mathematics, and so forth, or the Quarterly Journal, or AIAA, American Institute of Aeronautics, Astronautics, or ASME conference, or a turbulent shear flow conference, they'll send it to you. So you have to submit a paper, and of course the paper get accepted, and you make a presentation. So I kind of want to imitate that one. I would say call for a paper or a selection of a paper by you. And I would like to specify several subject area, for example, maybe direct numerical simulation, maybe chaos to turbulent, maybe large eddy simulations, more complex turbulence modeling, or if you like, if you find a paper on the two-phase turbulence model. So something that we have not really talked about in the class, I'd like to each one of you to select. Don't try to get too ambitious. Just like one paper, I would say, good. At most two papers for presentation, because I'm going to give you in our hour and 15 minutes, two papers each. So we need about 5 hours because we have 10 students. So we'll go through that presentations. So give you half an hour presentations is good, because most of the technical meetings, the presentation is about half an hour. So I want you to go and select a paper. Don't write your long-term paper or work on your things. It's just too much for you. So just select somebody's paper, study that paper, and knowledge enough to become the author of the paper, okay? And I want you to make a presentation as if you are the author of that paper in the class. And I think that's very good from my about 10, 15 years of doing this kind of things. I think a student come away with a good feeling, like a participating at technical sessions. And 10 people sitting on the audience, I would say that is about the average of the attendance. Because if you schedule out to Hawaii for a technical meeting, you find 600 people register. How many people show them in a technical session? 20 and 30. Where the other guy, everybody go out sightseeing, doing, talking to friend, and so forth. So, and also, if your paper is scheduled toward the end, the last day of a technical conference, I would say 60% of people already gone home. And I remember I end up in American Physical Society, one of the meeting, maybe early in the 70s. My paper was the last day, last sessions, and second paper from the last. So when I end up, how many people in there? Two authors, session chairman, and myself. Only four of us. And I spend about $1,000, go to the meeting, check in the hotel, register, and only three people listen to you. So if you have a 10 classmates that listen to you, you should be happy. It's a good technical session that you attend, and you don't have to pay any registration fee in there. All right? So we will try to do that next time.
Can you have a banquet?
Banquet is too costly. Maybe I can give everybody a chewing gum or something. The keynote speaker. Well, keynote speaker already speak the whole semester already, so it's an example. All right. Okay, if you don't have questions, let me quickly run through what we have been doing after the midterm. What we said is that we want to study turbulence. And turbulence is a messy stuff because of non-linearity. We have a chaos leading to the turbulence. How we treat the turbulence, there are variety of ways to do it. Numerical, direct numerical simulation, statistical way, large eddy simulation, and so forth. But for engineering approach and the quick way of getting capability of predictions, okay? If you just want to understand what happened, all you have to do is take a lot of measurement. And that is a post-prediction. After you measure, then you know what happened. But if you want to do the prediction, we have to use mathematical mean. for engineer in a kind of a macro approach, not a micro in a very detail, we choose to use, at least for me, I choose to do the turbulence modeling in a phenomenological way by looking at the each term and how we model it. So we choose to do an incompressible flow first and take an ensemble average of Navier-Stokes equation, you get that. And then we said we cannot close the program because of this UVWP, I need four equations, which is this, but I do have extra Reynolds stress. So we derive the Reynolds stress by taking the Navier-Stokes equation, instantaneous subtract the average, we get a governing equation for the fluctuating component of it. Out from that, we derive Reynolds stress equations. The trace of that one give us a K equation. In the K equation, we find there is an epsilon quantity which seems to naturally come out of it, which looks like to be important because it's a positive definite with a negative sign. So we said it's a rate of using up my kinetic energy. So we realize that K and epsilon is very important. And up to now, I think 90%, 99% of people think K and epsilon is important. So we will follow the general trend. We derive the epsilon equation. And at the beginning, epsilon was a little bit abstract and vague. So many people to choose to using a lens because come from the molecular collision, you say mixed mean free path, and you say the mixing lens is like a mean free path. So keep thinking each eddy is like a molecule rotating, colliding, and so forth. Plantel thought that way, G.I. Taylor thought that way, Rota thought that way, and even the Reynolds to some degree thought that way. But eventually evolved, you don't see the lens show up anywhere. And keep thinking a mixing lens seems to be more physical appealing to you, but logically it's not sound. Okay, so finally today I would say 80% of people using epsilon, still 5-10% more industrial people using mixing lens. There are some die-hard people don't want to use epsilon, they want to use omega, using some other new variable. Yes, there are a group of people try to do it, but most of people using epsilon equation. So out of that one, we said this equation is not close either because we derive the second order correlation, we find the triple correlation, some of them is very messy second order correlation like a pressure and strain term there. So we say we got to stop somewhere, and for engineer we want to stop here, it's already tough enough. And only when in after 1960, actually only in the recent 10 year computer become more available, this become a little bit more useful in terms of industrial application. Otherwise, in the 60 or 70, it's pretty much kind of academic world kind of grind. And rightly so, academic world got to be on the frontier of the knowledge. You take the lead and waiting for the computer technology catch up, and now the commercial has become available. So I think many of you probably graduate in 1 year or in 2 year or 3 year. I think you'll be just right in the heat of really good computer facility available, and the turbulence model is, it's kind of become a little bit better than it used to be, all right? So since it's still in the development, I cannot say, just to say one postulation like a stock principle and everybody follow and everybody agree with that. The turbulent postulations, I cannot guarantee you because everybody is going to say something different. But with my best as a teacher, I don't want to say go and read this paper, read that paper, and then you know what is happening. I collect them and summarize it for you. And so this is what we call turbulence model principle. So out of that principle, we find we can model equation like this. Remember I said this is the Bible turbulence model because when I was a graduate student I cannot have it, and now today I have it. I kind of feel happy I done my duty to you, being as a teacher for, I'm not quite 30 years in teaching yet, 27 years in teaching. I'm getting close, I got to retire soon I guess. So make a make an opening position for you to go and apply. So I'm, at least I'm happy that at least there's something available that you can work with. When I was a graduate student, I asked my advisor, if I want to calculate a separate turbulent flow, what equation I go? He said, no, I don't know, don't ask me, right? So today I said, well, Jim, you can try this. The only say that don't ask me about the accuracy of it. At least you got something to work with. But if I say that one, it would be a little bit gross. I would say that if you use this one to compute what a separate flow or swirling flow, I would say the mean flow velocity, you probably get it within one, within a factor of two, I would say. Okay? If it is 10 feet per second, you might experiment with 20 feet per second, I would say that. Now, if you say that how accurate is this K epsilon, that one, I would say sometimes, depending on the complication of the problem, can be off by a couple factor, all right? But if you do a simple flow that many people already check it, like a jet, wake, boundary layer, a simpler flow there, I would say that should give you a reasonable type of the solution. So that is the advance of, I was a graduate student in 60s, so now you are in the 90s, so you see 30-year difference make this much progress in our time. Certainly, I think if Reynolds is alive today, I'll show him, he's probably happy. Yeah, my Reynolds stress is still there. Yeah, right? So, okay, so with that, after the modeling, you see, let me kind of zoom it. Yeah. The Reynolds stress equation has a three constant. And the K, of course, following that, epsilon has a three constant. So if you want to solve only turbulent flow incompressible without temperature in there, you need a six constant, all right? And if there is a temperature there, you have another three constant there. So total of nine constant. Those nine constant, in the notebook, page 37, we already cited here. And these are the most use constant, and I begin to use a constant because most of people use constant, but I keep caution each one of you should think it can be variable. And indeed, later on, all kind of a modified function go with it, all right? Now we have a look through those, how those constants are determined. I didn't go through the coefficients detailed determination, but at least I give you the flavor that how it was determined, and I think you should by now have some general feeling of it, and you can looking at the couple flow that I cited over there. Essentially, we start to select the simplest turbulent flow possible, okay? We don't want to take it from the viscous meter and just increasing the speed to get to turbulent because our calibration of a coefficient is difficult. So you can see the general approach is that they make the mean flow simplest possible. Uniform flow, isotropic turbulent, uniform flow, non-isotropic turbulent, non-uniform flow, oscillatory flow with the turbulent, or the next complication is a straight line in the turbulent, and you can have a simpler. So many of these experiments, you're looking at it here, some of them are very early, 1963-57. You see, 1957, you don't have a laser anemometer yet. And those measurements is by hot wire, hot film, and so forth. Some of them may not be totally accurate, so maybe some of them can be repeated. Even the 1986 one I cited here is an oscillatory flow, even though it's my good friend Komatsu did, but he using a wood grid, shaking up and down. I think a mechanical engineer or the physicist can do better, a more accurate one. So this sort of, when I went to Japan, I talk in the, I serve as a special consultant for Japan electrical power industry, and that some of the suggestion I made. They make good measurement in one of the example is what they did. Let me see if I can quickly mention it here. I asked him to make a measurement on your page 122H. If you have a terminal node, page 122H, you can see there's a couple of Japanese name on top of that. That is where I suggest them to make a measurement of that one, and they did it a very good job. They take their own measurement and run their own turbulence model comparison and find out which model is good, which model is not good. So even in China, I go there, I keep urging them that if anyone interested in turbulent basic research, you ought to go back and repeat it to that oscillatory flow. See if you can measure pressure fluctuation and also a little bit better triple correlation there. But in any event, the constant or the coefficient was a generate. And at this, in my note, I can show you each coefficient has a corresponding experiment. If you read somebody's note, they might say that the sum of the diffusion, CK, C epsilon, that they tend to say it's a computer optimization, because indeed they did it. Without data, they just run so many cases and check, see if what number you put in there would more satisfy. All right? So with that one, I think we reached the stage, if you have no other mean of doing the prediction, then I would say use this. If you say that, well, I have a 10 supercomputer at my hand, I'm going to run every industrial application by direct numerical simulation, I say fine. But then I say, okay, how much time you need it? Then I follow that one, I'm going to ask you which method you are going to use for direct numerical simulation calculation, because if I have a bump, if I have a curve, if I have a separation flow, what method you are? Because right now the direct numerical simulation, most of the calculation using a spectral, and you got to have a Fourier transform in there. If anything in between, you're out of it. You cannot do it, okay? Then the next stage is that, well, maybe I have a 5 supercomputer available, I'm going to use a large AD simulation. I say, fine, let's go and see how much time you got to spend on it. Okay, so there's a variety of the way you can approach it, but as an engineer to earn your living today, I think this turbulence model is still the best bet in there. That's why so many commercial code now, everybody get on this. I don't think I have any direct numerical simulation numerical code commercially available to calculate the flow you wanted. All right? So right now, no. Even the large AD simulations, no. I haven't mentioned about the so-called renormalization group theory. Okay, there is another new approach to that. Maybe Vinay will make a presentation of that one, then we all learn there's another new method coming out. That, I only know one commercial company has a code on it, it's a Fluent company. What is the renormalization group there? Let me just quickly mention it. It essentially take a fluctuation equation that we have, MI, our fluctuation equation, and they make a Fourier spectral transformation. Making a Fourier transform, then what you essentially you put into the spectral domain, looking at the one mode at a time. And then the renormalization is that they take it from the smallest AD side. They make some assumption and calculate that equation, apply it back to next wavelength, get bigger in terms of wave in there. And they said by doing that one, they will be able to come up with a turbulence model. So they say, you don't need an experiment, we can determine all this turbulence constant. Okay, this constant we talk about doing experiment. They said, well, I only need to make an assumption on the small wave, and then I can renormalize by they using that name in there. I would say that a handful of people believe it. A large group of people still hesitate, or some of them don't want to believe it. So maybe we'll learn that one. That is something going on right now in the turbulent research right now. Okay, so with that, yes?
About the CMU and the
Okay, good question. That one. Today probably we will come to that too. Actually, we talking about instead of solving Reynolds stress in the differential equation. Last time we talked about if you're using just an intuitive physical feeling, you say the Reynolds stress exists because of gradient. All right. So you're using the so-called Buzinesque model. This is the 1887 or something like that. That's the 19th century theory. Okay. By generalize, the Buzinesque only take one Reynolds stress. These are the six here. Buzinesque actually only assume one, but we generalize the Buzinesque idea, make it six. That's why we have a little bit of a more kind of complete writing in there. Now the idea of eddy viscosity there is a Buzinesque idea, but the original Buzinesque is just say, oh, I'm going to give, since he physically know that the turbulent mixing is much more efficient than the molecular mixing, so he is adding this by just additive. We call it additive viscosity, just add 1,000 times, 100 times, just go and calculate. And he got a reasonable flow in the meteorological situation there. But later on we find that is not very good. Even the simple pipe flow is not good, because the simple additive there, your pipe flow never change from a parabolic profile to that common 1-7 kind of a profile. So that we know it. Simple additive is not good. That's why in the modern time we're using the length scale, the scale hypothesis, using K epsilon idea, we get this. So now with the K and epsilon calculate from differential equation put in here, this give a much better prediction than the Buzinesque original idea will be. Now your question of C mu being a 0.09, is that a constant or not? I hope we can get to it today. It is not. Let me see if I can dig them out. Since you ask now, let me kind of pull it out first. Again, this approach is very popular in the late 60s and particularly in 70s. Even today is quite popular. So, using a 0.09 to calculate, even a jet and wake using the same constant 0.09 would not match. Okay? So, this just happened in 1974. I went to Germany for my sabbatical year, so I spent a year in Germany. And the person I work with is Wolfgang Rodi, R-O-D-I. Rodi was barely 30 years old. He's still dating his girlfriend and so forth. But I'm a little bit older than him. I was 37 then, something like that. So we kind of team up together. And his thesis turned out to be study this C mu. Okay? His thesis has a variable. I have his whole thesis there. But let me show you how his a page of his thesis. I took it out here. You see, at that time, he has no computer to print. He's handwritten. This is his data. You can see his handwritten is pretty neat, right? Not too bad. In here, you can see here the C mu times the CD. There is another. Essentially, this is like a C mu, okay? Now, his advisor is a Professor Spalding. Spalding is very well known Imperial College. And his thesis is to find out C mu's variations, part of his thesis, okay? And the C mu's variation, but he doesn't know, because C mu is already computer calibrated. So he said, okay, I'm going to computer calibrate too. So he calculate, see how many flow he calculate. Run wake, run jet, plane jet, pipe flow, near homogeneous shear flow, mixing layer, flat plate boundary layer, and so forth. Okay? Now, you can see the C mu value change from 0.76 all the way down to 0.1 and to 0. Now you can see G's curve got to change depending on what flow you are calculating, and it depending on what the something he proposed is P is a production, okay? Like in our exam, PK is essentially, and he has epsilon, okay? So if P over epsilon is 1, means what you produce is what you consume, right? Because production and epsilon ratio is 1. So it's turbulent local equilibrium here, and that is 0.09. So C mu 0.09, he found out, is only when the turbulent flow is in local equilibrium. It's not in the local equilibrium. You can see the value can change here. Actually, some of the value can go very wild over here. And the value goes up when more dissipation than the productions.
Is the P and epsilon computer calculated for
Yeah, it's all computer calculated.
What model?
Well, you go through the calculation of this here, okay? You calculating K equation, epsilon equation, and then the Reynolds stress by that, okay? And then what he checked is that check, for example, jet, this slope of a jet widening up. Mixing layer, you have a layer thickness. He is checking a growth parameter, like a center line velocity is right or wrong, or grow this one. And he keep adjusting his C mu, adjusting back and forth, back and forth, go through all the computer calculation. And he find after the C mu, the value you give it, the rate of spread is right. And then he said, okay, this is the value I want. And then he record, his contribution is guessing that why the C mu got to be changed is because of a P over epsilon ratio. He just proposed that, okay? And he got, in his thesis, he did, and later on published that. And so everybody kind of use it. Yes?
I was gonna say, do they ever curve fit those, and people use that for particular types of flow?
Well, yeah, you see here, if you make a C mu as a function of a P over epsilon, so you can draw a curve, and you can put it as a one statement in your computer, all right? C mu, and you go through a calculation, P over epsilon is 1, you stay at 0.09. If it's greater than 1, you reduce a little bit. If it's smaller, you change a little bit. Yes?
Before the calculation, we don't know P over epsilon.
No. So you got to go and calculate the iterate.
And compare with the iterate.
Yeah, the compare. So you see, this is where maybe Professor Crosspari hated the turbulence model is going to come. Hey, Xie Chen, you are doing this curve fitting. It's not much fun. You just keep adjusting it. Right? So some people don't like it. They will criticize that you are doing turbulence model. But my feeling is, I'm not so much just for the modeling sake. But my feeling is that suppose we are the engineer, I have to do a prediction. What else I can do, right? It's not perfect, I know. I know it's not perfect, but at least Rodi did this work, then I know if the production on turbulent is not in balance, I can change C mu a little bit, looks like a prediction is going to be about right. So I use it as an engineer, right? So then I always use, you already heard me say, if you don't like it, give me the better model. Professor Crosspari cannot give me, I'm sure. If he give me a supersonic flow, a transonic flow work, and I say, are you sure this model work for this one, if I can take it to the pump, will work? It won't work. He probably, then I can go back to him. You see, you are adjusting your turbulence model too, so we are all in the same boat, right? So this is how it developed. Now, for this reason, actually, since you already asked these questions, for this reason, not many people, many people are still using this because of the simplicity. But if you want to say, gee, I really want a better foundation, I don't want to guessing and just fitting the curve, then they begin to go to this equation. Okay? Now, as I said, go to this equation, you also have a different kind of difficult, as I last time mentioned, because you are going to solve Reynolds stress. Okay? Now, if you solve Reynolds stress, remember this equation I mentioned about it, to what I know. Now, are you going to treat in the Navier-Stokes equation this as a source term? Because you are going to solve Reynolds stress, there is no simple form you can substitute into become a mean derivative here. So you can see your Navier-Stokes equation on the turbulent side after ensemble algebra, you have only viscous times the second derivative. And that viscous is very tiny because your flow, if you make it dimensionless, you are going to get a Reynolds number divide this term over. And the Reynolds number is large. For example, boundary layer, your Reynolds number 10 to the 6. If you sail an oil tanker in the ocean, it's 10 to the 8, right? Because oil tanker is so huge, you see? So your Reynolds number 10 to the 8, and you are almost reaching a singularity. That term divided by 10 to the minus 8, times 10 to the minus 8, you almost hit the singularity. You have some PC, your accuracy is completely out. So your highest derivative is only this, and the Reynolds stress got to be in the source term. Tough. You cannot solve it. All right? So you see, you got to struggle what you are going to do. And maybe there someone is going to invent a numerical method to stabilize that one, or as now our group, or maybe here, if we want to calculate, if Jim said that Professor Crossbody all of a sudden wake up, say, hey, I like turbulence model, you go and solve Reynolds stress, then you come to me, the professor Chen, what I'm going to do? Now my professor say, got to do this, then I say, divide this by the mean derivative, a time of derivative, and that mean derivative drift one numerical iteration. So you bring this one into the variable you are going to solve. So there is some kind of technique you can use to make it stable. Otherwise, I would say, Jim, go and tell him it's too tough. Professor Chen said, too tough. Use this equation for your program. And yes?
By doing this, you mean you put back the Reynolds stress and the convective?
You see, yeah. If you use this, you can substitute this into this term here.
No, I mean in the numerical method. So if you multiply by the derivative, the mean derivative, and divide by the derivative, so you just like shifting it back to the convective term, right?
That's you divide by a derivative, okay? A mean flow derivative such as like this, okay? And you time a derivative because you divide, you got to time it. But those two, then the Reynolds stress divided by the derivative is a previous iteration. And then, of course, you get a mean derivative here, which is the second order. So even you throw this one out, you are safe. You still have a second derivative in there. Okay? There are all kind of the trick there. You use only one half, and one half as the source. Patanka always do this. If you read the Patankas, that the Patanka always, the so-called source term linearizations way of doing it. So there is a numerical trick you got to learn in order to calculate turbulence. Okay, so that's a good question. So how the C mu is done. Not in that page, actually, in your note, page 72, you're looking at the page 72. This is what I gave you in my note. You see, 1.0 and it's 0.09. And C mu as a function of P over epsilon. Okay? So I call it a problem dependent function. You got to modify it. And that, I took it out from this. Okay? I took it out from his thesis. If you are curious, want to see the role is the whole thesis, how the 1972 Imperial College Dr. thesis looks like. You can take a look. Yeah. I think maybe Constantine or Natasha come from Europe there. I think a European graduate school, the Dr. thesis is a 100% fulfillment, the whole fulfillment of a Dr. Seuss. In the United States, your Dr. Seuss is only half. It's a partial fulfillment of your Dr. Seuss. So European Seuss tend to be much more content than the United States Seuss. Because the United States, you got to take a course. You got to satisfy the course in there. European, after you get your diploma, you just do thesis, maybe for 5-7 years, and then your major professor say, okay, write it up, Natasha, I'll let you graduate.
They can give you only 3 years.
3 years to graduate? So now they get a little bit easier, I guess. But in Paris, we met one Russian academic of engineer.
Sergey?
Yes, Sergey. He has a 15 PhD out of him. He is an academic member, but he can supervise a PhD student. He is from Moscow?
Yeah, he's from Moscow.
Moscow. Okay, so that's much comment there. We have a couple minutes to go. So let me quickly say that, actually, Josef kind of bring this one up. Already, let me go back and revisit again. Even though this is a fairly logical model that we build upon, the best we can do, although it's not perfect, we do have a model. And I, as I said, I'm kind of happy that at least I have something I can give somebody and kind of a proper advice at this stage. Say, okay, you can use this. However, for engineer computational, still too much. As a matter of fact, like last week, I also get from a Navy call, Dr. Yu Tai Lee call. Say, I heard of you doing a Cartesian grid calculation only. I want to calculate a turbulence. Can you use that one? Which turbulence model I'm supposed to use, and so forth? Okay. Now, for most of the application, you find K and epsilon is fine, only one equation, it's so two equations, but Reynolds stress is six partial differential equations, too much. So that's why this model, algebraic Reynolds stress model, still very attractive, even though we know it's not as accurate as a differential Reynolds stress model. Majority of people still like to use that, and particularly in the industry. But I would say, if you are doing a thesis in the university, because many people know that how accurate this one is, like Professor Rory, he said, no more using that one, you got to go more sophisticated one. Too bad, Natasha, you born too late, you pretty much have to think about doing something like that. But I would say, if your thesis is doing very complicated application, okay, like a floating jet or some kind of a new device, then I say, go ahead. Use that one because your thesis is not to study the turbulence as such. You are applying the flow, which is the turbulence. So you want to get some result out, then I would still use that. So if you use this one, we call it the K epsilon, which is still differential equation. Then I give it a E here as an eddy viscosity. Okay, so that is a one type of the simplest flow. And that normally also known as a two-equation model. Two equation in the sense, two differential equation you solve, okay? So in that. Now, if you have a heat transfer, you can do the same thing by extending the eddy viscosity model to the heat transfer by making a proportional to temperature gradient, just like a velocity gradient, and you can do that. Some of you say that I am not in the heat transfer field, I'm not in the engineering, but if you want to do a turbulent study, as I once mentioned it, turbulent heat transfer is still wide open. Not many people are doing a turbulent heat transfer study. So if you want to get in just a turbulent flow, lots of people doing it. A turbulent heat transfer, not many people in there. So heat transfer field will be good to go in. Okay, so that is one type of the simplification. Another type of simplifications, last time we did look at it, is to go back and examine this equation. We know in that this is too ad hoc, just by the too intuitive in there. So you go back and visit this equation again. and kind of ask, gee, I really like to have an algebraic equation out of this. So what can I do? Well, if I drop this term and drop this term here, if I cover this two out here, the rest of them, even though it looks complicated, but they are all algebraic, because the Reynolds stress has no appearance as a derivative. So you say, okay, how about let's just drop this two and call it algebraic stress model, okay? Instead of AD stress model. So that, sometimes I would like to call it, now you're solving K and epsilon, and without that one, you're solving that one, is K epsilon, still two equation model, you see? Two equation differential model, but you are using algebraic stress model. So it comes sometimes as algebraic stress model, or the called AMS, algebraic model, AMS.
ASM.
ASM, the algebraic stress model in there. Or some people just say, I'm using a still two equation model, then you got to say, two equation model, what did you do with your Reynolds stress? He said, well, I'm using AD viscosity, then you know. I'm using algebraic, then you know it. Right? So those are the three most popular one here. And sometimes if people using all of this equation, they say that full Reynolds stress model. Full, that means everything, okay? So that are the three types in there, okay?
Okay?
Yes?
How common is it now today for people to use the RSM model, full Reynolds stress model?
No, how come?
I mean, no, how common is it? I mean, because I really haven't seen a lot of
that's right.
Publications.
That's right.
That
well, not many people, well, they would like to, I would say, only is pushing the turbulence model people who use it. Like Milwaukee, Professor Amano, Professor Brian Londa in the University of Manchester. Even Professor Spalding is not using. Maybe he's getting old, he wants to retire. Professor Rody, I talked to him in Japan in August, and he said, yes, with some of the program we'll use a Reynolds stress model. The differential Reynolds stress model. So I would say that maybe in terms of a university, I would say that I know maybe 5, 7, at most 10 school is using it. In Germany, probably it's Karlsruhe. Munich, I don't know anyone. Hamburg, I don't think anyone. In France, maybe Grenoble group that has a nuclear, they have a more powerful computer available. In the University of Paris 1234, I don't know anyone is really doing it.
Do the people who've used it, have they presented results showing that their results are, you know, significantly better than?
No, as it turned out, because of what we have to do with this term,
okay, that's the,
that might create, so it's not truly a full Reynolds stress result, for one. Some people have a numerical difficult, okay, like Amano in the Milwaukee. But he presented his result anyway by making some trick in there. Also, many people discuss about you see this two term here, it's a pressure strain term. Remember, we did it a very coarse approximation by integrating a volume, shrink to a volume, and then you guess it must be this way, and make it only incompressible goes to zero. So there are many people don't like this one. I say that, full Reynolds stress model is not doing the job, is this is not quite right. And to some degree, I got to agree. But I keep telling them that, you see, don't just bring that one. How about bring the epsilon equation? I say epsilon equation, this two term is very suspicious too, right? And then they say, well, then how come still doing okay? Then I say, well, the mistake you made here, you pick it up by CU, right? you might compensate that. You just try to compensate the mistake from something you made by some other place. So there are many things that we do not know yet. Okay. So for that reason, you begin to find also in the recent about 10 years, 5 years, I think a Professor Spiegel in New Jersey is at Stephen Institute or Rochester Institute in there. You see, he looked at this, he said, gee, this is a linear model, isn't it? The Reynolds stress is linear to the velocity here. He said, let's create a nonlinear term, okay? So he is going to add the nonlinear term of that one into it. I don't like it, but he's making a big wave, and the Navy thought that, well, for the Navy submarine calculation, something, just a quick fix. And so he getting a contract from the Navy to do some research on the so-called nonlinear eddy viscosity model, right? So there's a paper coming out too. So you see, there's a, now you begin to realize, as I'm telling you, I try to honestly, frankly tell you how I think the most basic one, and then all of the other one is kind of spring out depending on the desirability of a quick fix or do something, or try to get something going for his own use. Yeah. So many things going on, all right? Okay, now let's go back to this. When we drop this, we cannot just say, drop it without reason. So we will seek for the why this, sometimes we can drop it, and the calculation still looks a little bit better, okay? You say that there is a whole lot of paper, some of them is worse, okay? But most of the time, I can show you an example, it's better than this. Okay, why is this? Let me tell you, if a velocity gradient is zero, Reynolds stress, shear stress is what? When I say gradient, is like a u, y, partial u, partial y. If that is equal to zero, then this goes to zero, you see? So is that all the flow, when you see the velocity profile, gradient goes to zero, Reynolds stress zero? No. Okay? So right away you know it, this has a defect. Right away, just from the very fundamental, you look at, actually there are some example in that one, you can look at it. Though it's not good. Now, if you drop this two, and just say, okay, it's an algebraic stress model. So you begin to question, is this better than that the Buzinesque Reynolds stress model? As it turned out, yes. This, when you calculate, when the velocity gradient is not equal to zero, and yet there's a Reynolds stress exists in the experimental measurement, this will be able to give you some value. Not necessarily very accurate, but at least it shows non-zero. So just from that idea, you know that the algebraic stress model should be a little bit better. Okay? Should be a little bit better. Now, go back to here. When we can drop this one, you can see this is a convection, this is diffusion. Now, if I have a local equilibrium, that means all the production I made is either redistributed or consumed is by this, right? You see, this is the productions over this one here, this dissipation, this redistribution. So you say that looks like my turbulent flow situation is more like in a local equilibrium, then looks like this I can drop it, because I don't convect it away, I don't diffuse it away. So it turned out to be, as last time we looked at it, it is a situation where you want to drop this, and that is when you have a very large velocity gradient. Large velocity gradient give you this thing's large, and that is small. So as it turned out, algebraic stress model for simple shear flow, bundle layer flow, jet, wake, mixing layer, they all do a little bit better. Okay? Let me at this stage kind of mention it. Maybe I'm a little bit ahead of the note, but I think just as a totality of discussions, the model we create up to now seems not be able to predict very complicated, I wouldn't say complicated, the swirling flow. Swirling flow like this. If you have a nozzle, like a chemical engineer had a cyclone, right? You want to separate flow, go like this. You say it's a turbulent, you calculate there. The swirling flow velocity prediction tend to be lower than what the experiment show. And many people are still studying why this model will not do that one. Now, when I want to almost say that the complicated flow, but then I take it back, actually the complicated flow, because of the pressure gradient is large, like a bend, you are going to do very well, because all the mean flow is created by the turbulent gradient, the pressure gradient, not by the Reynolds stress there. So actually very complicated flow actually sometimes looks very good. The turbulence model is going to look very good. So actually, if you want to cheat a couple of the professors don't know much about the turbulence model, pick a very complicated problem and calculate Reynolds stress model or eddy viscosity model, you say great thesis. Great thesis, everything seems to fit very well. Because Reynolds stress, you're looking at this here. Time rate change of the velocity is controlled by what? Gravitational force, pressure force, viscous force, and Reynolds stress. So you pick a problem, this is very large. Let's say this is 90%, and this is only 10%. So 50% of 10% error, nothing. Right? So you can get a great thesis out of it. And Dr. Banka Pratap from India and the Imperial College, he just did a thesis exactly like that. No matter what kind of turbulence model you use, result still looks great. Right? So you can do that. Okay, I think actually by talking this way, I already more or less covered the material I want to talk about today. Okay, so only 5 minutes to go. Let's quickly look at the one calculations. Okay? So now I already kind of talk ahead a little bit. Let's say, let me see if I can zoom this one. Okay. Now I said that, well, we talk about so much model, actually I already hinted that this model's performance. So I said, let's try to do the prediction now. With the model created, and with the experiment we use to calibrate constant, you cannot use for the prediction, otherwise you cannot circle argument. So you got to predict something which you have not used for determination of constant. So I would say the first one I want to use is the free shear. You remember that our pressure strain term, we got to integrate the whole volume. If you're very near the wall, you are in trouble, because near the wall, you cannot start with a very large volume to integrate. So we know if the turbulent flow near the wall, the turbulence model so far we talk about it is not going to do a good job. So let's look at the free shear, okay? Now free shear is a good test of all the model you create up to now, okay? Now the free shear, we are going to pick this couple flow. One is a jet, one is a wake, one is a mixing layer, okay? And I draw a picture there. Now, you say, you are cheating, you get an easy way out, you pick this very simple flow so that your turbulent prediction is good. And I said, exactly contrary to this. I pick this is a very tough flow for you to predict. Why? This flow all goes to infinity. Okay? If you make a mistake here, the mistake is going to add it up. You are going to see the error downstream right away, very easy. Second, this flow for a jet, wake, mixing layer, In the free stream flow, do I have a pressure gradient? I don't have a, for example, I sneeze or I put a jet here, right? Outside pressure gradient is uniform. Now you know at what I'm talking, looking at the, this equations. If I want, really want to give it a good test of my turbulence model, I want this will be 100% important in determining my time rate change or my velocity. I want the gravity has no part in there, incompressible, I take it out. I pick a uniform flow outside, no pressure gradient. I don't want you to come in so that I can have a good test of this. I don't want to have a molecular viscosity because turbulence dominate everywhere unless there is a near wall. So you see, this get rid of, this get rid of, this get rid of, and now Reynolds stress comes in, and if any mistake here is going to show up my your profile. Okay? So you realize that choosing this simple flow is a good test, is a good test. Okay? Now 1 minute to go. Let's just look at one example, and then let's call it a class here. Okay, we're looking at differential model. That means a full Reynolds stress equation. The first thing I want to say is that, okay, let's take the full equation to see if anyone has done it. And it's in 1970, maybe, at the Imperial College, because Imperial College in the 70s was leading in doing the turbulence model. And under the Professor Landa, you met Hanjelek, right? Professor Hanjelek now, that was a student then from Yugoslavia, the Hanjelek. He did a CCS calculating this. That means everything is the differential equation. That's tough in the 70s with a computer so small available. But he did it with a very simple flow, like a shear flow here. So you can see like a boundary alike. Okay, only Reynolds stress determining your velocity profile. Continuity equation, no pressure gradient in the y direction, x direction. Now, if you want to calculate Reynolds stress, you got to solve the full Reynolds stress equation, right? In here, you have a epsilon and a k and the v square there, all right? Here's page 59 on your note there. So now you got to calculate the v square, you got to calculate K and the epsilon. That is the full equation. That is what I put down. Okay, I put down. And as it turned out, Hanjelek did not calculate exactly that. The one he calculated is in my square box here. He calculated Reynolds stress, all right? But he doesn't want to mess around with one more partial differential equation. He said, I know from the experiment, most of the V square is about half of a K in the experiment. So he's just going to get rid of V equation, do that. But he did solve K and epsilon. So essentially he solved three equation model, okay? Actually he should solve four, as I said here, Reynolds stress, V square, K and epsilon, that will complete the model. But he said, oh, I don't want to solve this one, I'm going to replace it by that, okay? And he used a two set of a constant. Well, the constant, six constant, okay? Six constant, Ck, C, epsilon, this redistribution constant, and epsilon equation there, okay? So let's look at the result, and then we'll call it the class for today. You're looking at the plane jet, two-dimensional jet. That means a jet come out from a slot and open up like this, and the velocity profile like that. Okay, so velocity profile like this, and I don't know how many of you in the viscous flow talk about the so-called half width. That in the jet, this is here, and the so-called half width is from the center line to the edge of jet. You see, the edge of jet is so uncertain, so floppy, unstable. So looking at the edge there is not a good idea. So many people want to looking at the half of your center line velocity, okay? Half of center line velocity will be located here, okay? And that we call it y.5. That means the half of the velocity there. And you're looking at because the jet is open up, the half of the center line velocity is also have a slope here. So you're looking for that. And the prediction of that one is one major parameter. Then, of course, you have a half of the velocity profile, Reynolds stress profile, and the kinetic energy profile. And that has all experimental measurement. You're looking at the measurement here, compared with the predictions. Measurement is the dotted line here, compared with the predictions. And experiment is my green color with a long line dot there, compared with the predictions. Looks pretty good, isn't it? Yeah. So in his thesis, I think the Hanjelek thesis is a good thesis. He calculate many other flow, plane jet, wall jet, also the channel with a different roughness in there. So I don't have a Hanjelek original thesis. I'd like to get hold of a copy. But this is published in the Journal of Fluid Mechanics. So you know it's a good quality journal there. So you can look at it. So this right away kind of make you feel comfortable. I say, gee, we work so hard for about a month or maybe of our class time working on turbulence model, it turned out to be not too bad. So you see, there is a prediction capability in there. Now I just tell you the good story side. Next time we meet, I'll tell you the bad story. But some of the turbulence model doesn't work. Okay, so we stop here. Read ahead of your note here, and note is a little bit sketchy, but at least I organize in a way you should be able to follow it. Okay, I will see you next Tuesday. Okay.